This. Today we are very happy to have a very senior faculty, Dr. Neeraj Jain sir. He is he doesn't require an introduction, but just for formality sake, I will do his introduction. And it's an honor to introduce somebody who's both FIP and SIPS. And at his age, when he did SIPS, I think it's all the more respect even increases for him. And he's a senior consultant, interventional spine and pain specialist across all major hospitals in North Delhi. And he is, actually this one slide is quite small for his achievement. He's a faculty for certified basic and advanced interventional pain management techniques in national and international conferences. And the most important thing is that he's pioneered some of the non-surgical percutaneous fluoroscopic ultrasound or CT guided pain management procedures in spine disc disease, fracture spine, cancer, or chronic pain disease. He has got a large series of successful percutaneous needle discectomies with balloon neuroplasties, which is a unique technique to him, vertebroplasties and kyphoplasties to his credit. And his aura is such that even surgeons' conferences seem incomplete without his presence. And I think he's got his world record of 6 level vertebroplasties also to his name. He's actively participated, of course, and interacted with world leaders in pain management at various world congresses. So we welcome you, sir. I think...
It's my pleasure, my friends, and thank you for calling. Thank you for calling.
Great. So now, without spending any much time, we should go on to the presentations for today. So over to you, Dr. Sanjog and Dr. Anchal. I think Dr. Anchal will present first. Dr. Anchal, if you can put your slide, I will introduce you and then you can begin. Yes, we can see your screen. So let me introduce Dr. Anchal Sharma. She's MD Anesthesiology from PJIMER Chandigarh, and she's got her fellowship in pain medicine from Chicago, US. She's one of the very few physicians working in India who are board certified from American Board of Pain Medicine. She's currently working as a consultant in pain and palliative care at Venkateshwar Hospital, Dwarka, New Delhi, and also at New Life Multispecialty Hospital, Gurugram, Haryana. So welcome, Dr. Anchal, you can begin now.
Thank you for the introduction. So the topic for today from my side is it's a prospective randomized double-blinded parallel trial study. With the title of Comparative Analysis of Fluoroscopic Guided and Ultrasound Guided SI Joint Injection in Patient with Clinical Sacroiliitis. It was done by Sham Shrey et al. And this journal is, this paper is published in Indian Journal of Pain in the year of 2020. And it was done by Department of Anesthesiology at SGPGI, Lucknow. So SI joint, we all know, it's a diarthro-amphiarthrosis joint containing a synovial fluid enclosed by a outer fibrous joint capsule in lower two-thirds of the joint space. And various conditions can affect this joint, like old age, true and apparent length discrepancy, inflammatory arthritis, previous spine surgery, pregnancy, trauma, etc. And when it comes to the treatment, it's mainly conservative strategies such as exercises or medications. And in non-responders, they do intra-articular injections of SIJ with LA and steroid, provides short to medium term therapeutic benefit. So the injection is done either anatomic landmark, which is successful in only 12 to 22% patients. There's another technique, fluoroscopic guidance, which improves the accuracy to 60% in first attempt, but it also is limited by the requirement of proper infrastructure, radiation exposure, and additional cost. Another imaging modality is ultrasound, which is, of course, cost-effective. It's easily available, avoids radiation exposure, and it gives a real-time visualization of the needle tip and the surrounding structures. So studies which have done in the past, they concluded the equivocal analgesic and functional outcome of SIJ injection using either ultrasound or fluoroscopic as an imaging modality while doing the injection. So to address this gap of technical skill and difficulty, and analyze the learning curve of a novice using two different image-guided techniques, that is ultrasound and fluoroscopy, they conducted a randomized parallel group trial, but their primary objective was to evaluate pain score at the end of 1 month after SIJ intervention. So the primary objective was just to see the patient in the sacroiliitis group, what was the decrease in the pain score, irrespective of the imaging modality used. But the secondary objective was to compare the pain score at 24 hour, 1 week, and 3 months, level of disability and psychological aspects affecting quality of life at 1 month and 3 months post-intervention. And the third one was to assess the learning curve of a novice in terms of time taken, number of attempts, ease of performance between the two imaging modalities. So after obtaining the written and informed consent, patients were randomized into two groups, group A, who received injection through fluoroscopic guidance, and group B, in which ultrasound was used. Inclusion criteria was patient diagnosed as sacroiliitis with characteristic history and at least 3 positive physical examination maneuvers, which is first one is Faber and Ginslin's, Yeoman and Gillette and Chair test. So 3 of them was found to be positive during their physical exam, ASA grade 1 and 2. And patient should have moderate to severe pain that is defined as NRS more than 3, which was refractory to oral inflammatory, anti-inflammatory therapy and exercises for at least 3 months. So they excluded if the age was less than 18 or more than 60 years old, BMI more than 35, if patient had severe anxiety or depression, it was allergic to local anesthetic or steroids, pregnancy, and multiple other comorbidities. So after excluding the patient according to the criteria and the patient who refused to participate, they finally randomized 38 patients, which was allocated to group of fluoroscopy or ultrasound. And there were 19 patients each. None of them lost to follow-up and none of them was excluded in analysis. So 19 patients in each group were finally analyzed. So intervention was after securing an IV line, standard monitors like ECG, pulse ox, BP were applied. The patient was in prone with the pillow below the LS spine to neutralize the lordosis. The skin over SI joint was cleaned and draped, and with either modality, final medication was given as 1.5 ml of 2% lignocaine with triamcinolone of 40 milligram. So, and just to mention, the bilateral sacroiliitis was excluded. So it is only the unilateral sacroiliitis. So first coming to the ultrasound group. So a Sonosite M-Turbo US machine, they mentioned they used the linear transducer probe, the frequency of 6 to 13 megahertz. The probe was placed transversely over the distal sacrum in the midline to identify the sacral cornua and hiatus. So you can see clearly in the picture, 2 sacral cornua and the hiatus with the sacrococcygeal ligament above. And this is the base of the sacrum. So then the probe was moved laterally and cephalate to visualize the lowermost part of the SI joint, which is available as hypoechoic shadow. So they say that they use a linear probe, but this looks like the convex probe was used. But as you can see in the picture, the sacrum, the bony shadow, and the ileum, and then you can visualize a needle coming through. So the hypoechoic shadow between the two bones is the SI joint where you put the needle and inject your medication. So marker placement. So once they figure out this joint, a marker was placed over this hypoechoic shadow, and then later it was confirmed by fluoroscopy. And if this marker was not found over the SI joint, then scanning was repeated and this attempt was counted as 1 attempt. But if it was found satisfactory, then they gave the LA followed by the insertion of their spinal needle and then using a ultrasound for real-time visualization, they reached inside the joint, and after the needle placement was confirmed by the dye injection through fluoroscopy, the placement was of course not intra-articular. They took a new attempt, but if it was intra-articular, then intervention was declared complete. And all the procedures was done by single interventionalist who were taught and demonstrated the procedure 5 times before hands-on. So the second group is fluoroscopic guided SI joint injection. Same position, C-arm rotated contralaterally to approximately 5 to 20 degree, with craniocaudal angle of 5 to 10 degree to, of course, identify the inferior most aspect of the joint. And then the after LA infiltration, 22 gauge spinal needle with the posterior part was contacted. You can see this needle going to the lowermost part of the SI joint, and they gave 0.5 ml of the dye to confirm the intra-articular injection. So after both the procedure, when we already discussed the medicine injected, Post procedure, they were observed for 2 hours, and they were all were given doricoxib 60 milligram, which was taken for 5 days, followed by PCM SOS in all the patients. So data which was collected in all these patients was NRS, the depression anxiety stress scale, and Oswestry disability index. And it was measured before intervention, 24 hours after, 1 week, 1 month, and 3 months after the intervention. Coming to the NRS, we know it's a patient self-reporting scale of the pain, with 0 being no pain and 10 being the worst pain. And the DAS score is, it's a questionnaire designed to measure the severity of 3 related negative emotional states, which is depression, anxiety, and stress. And the third one is Oswestry disability index. It is a level of disability which is quantified due to the low back pain. And self-completed questionnaire, which contains 10 topics, and the scores are from 0 to 100, 0 being no disability, 100 being the maximum disability possible. So the learning curve was, for the learning curve, the, which was our secondary objective, the data collected and analyzed was number of attempts required, ease of performance, which was scored from 0 to 10, 0 being very easy, 10 was extremely difficult, and time taken to perform the procedure, which is calculated in minutes. In fluoroscopic group, time recorded was from the first fluoroscopic image they took until the dye injection, including the radiographic confirmation of the dye. In ultrasound group, time recorded was from the first probe placement till the intra-articular needle placement, but they deducted the fluoroscopic timing, which they took intermittently. So coming to the results and discussion, as far as demographics are concerned, they have related age group, and there was little higher female preponderance in fluoroscopic group and higher male in the ultrasound. And then coming to our NRS and DAS and ODI in the two groups. So as you can see in the baseline, was same when you see the NRS, it's 7.39 versus 7.22 in ultrasound. But as the time passes, 24 hours first week, it is decreasing in fluoroscopic group as well as in the ultrasound group. So there was significant improvement as when you see the pain group in both the modalities, and all of the pain scores are, there is a statistically significant improvement. Then coming to depression anxiety severity scale. So you do see that there, the baseline is same, but then there is a decrease in the anxiety and depression severity index, both in the fluoroscopic and ultrasound, and both of them showed statistically significant improvement. And then the disability index, similarly, baseline is same, 45 versus 46, and then the decrease is seen in the both the modalities, and both the modalities showed statistically significant improvement. Then coming to the intergroup comparison, fluoroscopic versus ultrasound, then you can see then there is no major difference where you can see in either group. So both of them did decrease the pain score. They did improve the depression anxiety severity index as well as the disability one. But when you come to the curve of learning, the mean number of attempts in two groups was slightly lesser on the fluoroscopic side and slightly higher on the ultrasound group. And this was found to be statistically significant as well. If you see this graph, the series one, which is blue color, is the fluoroscopic group. And you can see the number of attempts as you go on increasing the procedure they're doing, it kind of, decreases. So it's more easier. They learn through fluoroscopic more quickly than the ultrasound you see. It did come down, but then, in the beginning it's higher. So this is intra-articular needle placement achieved in fluoroscopic group was in 21% in the first attempt, 53 and 26 in second and third attempt, versus ultrasound group, which is only 11% compared to 21% in fluoroscopic, and then 26, 47. So all the three figures are, less, and even some of them, like 16% of the cases did require even the fourth attempt in the ultrasound group. So these are the procedure-related variables comparing the two groups. So ease of performance, you can see it's fluoroscopic, they rated it more easier to perform. Number of attempts was slightly lower. And then the time taken was also lower in the fluoroscopic group. So coming to the discussion, studies in the past have compared fluoroscopic and ultrasound guidance in SIJ injection, and then they showed the mean NRS score of 2.5 at the end of 12th week compared to 0.8 and 1.7 in the studies. They have seen two possible differences could be for this, two possible reasons for this difference could be the endpoint in the study was intra-articular as against the intra versus peri-articular injection in other studies. And the endpoint was validated by fluoroscopic in both the groups, hence increasing the accuracy of performed intervention. So chronic pain, we know that it's frequently accompanied by distressing emotions like stress, anxiety, lack of sleep, anger, which have not been quantified till date in case of SIJ-related pain. So quantification of psychological impact of this pain and its relief was done during DAS score in this paper. An absolute decrease in mean DAS score was seen even at 12 weeks in both the groups, indicating that the transformation of patient from severe state of distress to mild state if you take care of their pain. And the comparable effect between the two groups can be related to full in decrease in chronic pain, which increases increases norepi, dopamine, and serotonin levels, which is depleted otherwise in chronic pain patients. In terms of procedures, Novus performed the intervention only after observing and assisting 5 cases using both the modalities. So we have discussed this, that the the fluoroscopic was rated more easier than the ultrasound. And the difference, of course, could be because of anatomical clarity, which is more obvious in fluoroscopic than the ultrasound. So limitation accepted by them was there was a single Novus involved to assess the learning curve. But studies including more number of Novus performance should be undertaken in the future, they say. Both intra and the periarticular injections could be included in either group. And other than dye confirmation, needle position should be validated by fluoroscopy. So critical analysis from my side. This is the paper where, along with the pain relief, they have discussed psychological impact of the pain, which is very important clinical aspect when you see patient as a whole. So we should also focus on this aspect rather than just the pain score. And then sacroiliitis patient was included, and the results were found to be similar, even better than compared to the SIJ arthritis and arthropathy, which is done in the previous studies. So we can see that even sacroiliitis patient, this is helpful. But the only thing I would say is figure shown in the ultrasound intervention doesn't seem to be done by linear probe, as they have mentioned, as I discussed. So take home message from my side, both ultrasound and fluoroscopic guidance provide equivalent outcomes when you see pain, disability, and psychological impact in SIJ interventions. Ultrasound is, of course, technically more challenging and requires a greater skill. So hence, a novice should be first trained using fluoroscopy, followed by ultrasound for these procedures. And they say minimum of 8 fluoroscopic guided and 13 ultrasound guided interventions under supervision are required to attain a consistent performance.
Thank you, Dr. Anshul. I think that was quite a comprehensive paper and a great presentation. So Dr. Neeraj, sir, will you like to have questions now?
I think there are two things now here. It was a very good presentation on a very good paper, actually. It is a very good job done, and I must compliment you for this. There are a few questions which are relating to your paper, and there are a few questions which will be relating to Sonaji paper, which is the next paper. And they're quite parallel in works, you know. So I think I'll be asking few things now and few things later on, and then I'll couple them up, you know. So there are a few points which I think you have to elaborate on, and which is something to focus on. Is something, was there any medication given to these patients pre-operatively, pre-procedure? Any medication they were on? Any mention of that?
Not that they mentioned of. Only the post-procedure, which I discussed.
Only post-procedure. So I think probably that was something to know, because we want to take some patients who are on a high 3 out of 10 score, you know, before you started the procedure. There's a moderate to severe one. Another point which was to my mind, which is important and pertinent here, we are doing a study. What are we studying? Are we studying the noviceness of the procedurist or the interventionist, or are we checking the procedure per se, the new procedure like ultrasound for SIJ? So there are two variables now, two uncertainties here in this paper, which I think it is kind of, you know, caught my intention, is that you're taking somebody no eyes and some new procedure. So that you either check one person or the procedure. Now you're checking both the things together. So that as two variables are difficult variables. So I think where you said there are five procedures which was demonstrated, as I read the paper, were demonstrated to the person. And when you say the expertise, he has got expertise of 8 procedures in fluoro and 13 in ultrasound. He got a time expertise, stabilization of the time expertise, right?
They said
during,
that that's
during
a,
the study.
Right.
You showed the graph. So after 8 fluoro and 13 ultrasound, there was stabilization of the timing part, right? So we should do a study from then to know the procedure thereafter. You see, before that it was the procedurist who has been checked. After that, the procedure can be checked. So you cannot take two variables and then you count them accordingly. So that is my contention to really hit there. And another point was the demography. When you say demography, there was 14 females and 4 male in the fluoro group, and 7 female and 11 male in the ultrasound groups. So when you're doing blinding of the groups, how come there's such a big variation in the population, male-female population? So that was my concern, another concern, you know, they should be equal, somewhere equal, you know, but 14 and 4 is different. Another point, if you catch it here, is 14 and 4 makes 18, 11 and 7 makes 18, but there were 19 people in
but
each
there
group.
There were 19 patients
in each group. So where is one gone? Where is one missing? You see 14 and 4 in one group, and there's 11 and 7 in the ultrasound group. So where is the 19th person gone? So the calculation varies, you know. So that is my another thought, you know, I thought I'll share with you. And it's these are important things, because then you can put in critical analysis. My point was here. You have to mark these points, you know. And why they say the NRS is different in fluoro than ultrasound group, which is mentioned again, again and again. The fluoro are doing better than the ultrasound group. But in your study, if you just see that you've done a fluoro check and then you did ultrasound, fluoro after the ultrasound to check, it is intra-articular. See, in your study, then the other study which he is going to talk, he is this periarticular plus intraarticular. Your all needle tips at the end of the ultrasound procedure is intraarticular. So how come the NRS is different? Now you almost as a fluoro. So how come it is different in ultrasound and NRS group, the ultimate results? You know, they have to be equitable. In other words, that is my another thought. And if you very closely observe the procedure part, somebody like you are doing or I am doing the procedure, you're doing an ultrasound check for the SIJ, right? You did a right thing. You started from cornua and went up. Like in other study, they started from above and came down. Then you did a fluoro check for the needle position, right? And then you went inside fluoro ultrasound guided. You took the needle to the SIJ. And then you did a dye check with the fluoro. And then again, you finished with the procedure with ultrasound. So you have two fluoros and three ultrasound timings. And you have deducted two fluoro timings from the procedure. So that is another point, and there was no mention of the radiation count in the fluoro group. Like same study, they did in other study, they didn't check the how much is the radiation in the ultrasound group, which they should have compared. Actually, I personally think so. Another point to bring up here, which is pertinent, is when you're doing ultrasound procedure, we always say your eye, your needle, and the monitor should be in one line. You know, that's what normally we speak of, right? But here is when you're doing a procedure, then again you're bringing a C-arm in, you have to either move your trolley, ultrasound trolley, and then put it back again. So there are few, you know, machine clashes here. But for a study reason, good. But for day-to-day things, we really have to calculate how far we can do it. Yes, I always welcome, if I'm doing ultrasound guided, put in a dye and check with the fluoro, I'll be much happy. Although it is said openly that intra-articular or extra-articular, the results are almost same in few studies which has already been there. So this is something I thought I'll bring to your knowledge notice, and we can dissect upon later on. There are few more questions which is common to both the groups. So I'll be talking at the end of the second talk, but they're important. They're very, very important. At the end of the day, I'll be talking few things about the needle visualization, number one. This is important. And then ultrasound vis-a-vis fluoroscopy in SIJA. Point of view. So that'll be a message giving for everybody, you know, including you all. So we can go to the next talk, and then again we come to the point.
Great. So Dr. Sanjog, you can start your screen share. Let me introduce Dr. Sanjog. So Sanjog, can you put your slide? Great. So Dr. Sanjog Mekewar is DA DNB and fellowship in pain medicine. is a consultant spine and pain physician at various hospitals across Pune. He's also visiting consultant at BJ Medical College and Sassoon Hospital at Pune. And he's also the director of Jivisha Pain Management Center in Pune. His area of interest is spine endoscopy and regenerative medicine. And he's got some publications as well in the national journals. He's an avid traveler and explorer. Great. So, Dr. Sanjog, please begin.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for the introduction. Good evening, everyone. So the paper that I'm going to discuss today is titled as the comparison of fluoroscopy and ultrasound guidance for sacroiliac joint injection in patients with chronic low back pain. So this was a prospective randomized controlled trial, which was conducted by Nilesh Sonji et al. And from the University of Toronto and Queen's University, Toronto, Ontario, Canada. And this study was published in Pain Practice in 2015. Now, as we know, sacroiliac joint arthritis is a common pathology affecting 15 to 30% of the individuals with chronic mechanical lower back pain. Now, intra-articular local anesthetic plus steroid is an intervention which is most commonly performed for this sacroiliac joint arthritis. And Dr. Achal has already talked about the three techniques, that anatomical landmark technique, fluoroscopy guided technique, and ultrasound guided SI joint injection. So now the prior studies which are conducted estimated the accuracy of ultrasound guided intra-articular injection to be 40 to 80%. There were also two studies which suggested that the therapeutic value of a periarticular SIJ injection may be similar to that of the intra-articular injections. And there was only one study which evaluated the intermediate term, that is few weeks to few months analgesic impact after the injection. So to address these lacunae in the current knowledge about impact of different image-guided techniques, authors conducted this prospective randomized controlled trial comparing the impact of ultrasound and fluoroscope guidance for SIJ injections. So this trial was registered with clinicaltrials.gov with this registration number, and 40 patients were prospectively enrolled for ultrasound guidance of fluoroscopic guided SIJ injections at two multidisciplinary pain clinics and teaching hospitals in Toronto. Now, separate research coordinators for patient allocation and post-procedure data collection, they were allocated. Now, in the inclusion criteria, the study included the patients who had characteristics of SIJ disease on history, at least three positive physical examination maneuvers, Faber-Posch, Rehber-Fortins finger test, moderate to severe pain, that is NRS pain score more than 3 out of 10, which was refractory to oral anti-inflammatory and or opioid analgesic therapy. Now, in the exclusion criteria, they excluded the patients whose age was less than 18 or more than 85 years, BMI above 35 kilogram per meter square, pain suggestive of bilateral sacroiliac joint involvement, a diagnosis of severe anxiety or depression, allergy to local anesthetics or steroids, pregnancy, and multiple comorbidities. Now, in the intervention, the patients were given prone position, 22 gauge, 8 centimeter long quinquae spinal needle was used for the procedure. The injected included 40 milligrams of methylprednisolone acetate diluted in 3 ml of bupivacaine 0.25% with epinephrine of 1:2 lakh. Total 4 ml injected was prepared. Injections were performed by staff pain physicians experienced in using both the image-guided modalities of the, that is ultrasound and fluoroscope for SIJ injection. Now, needle tip location was confirmed by injecting the radioopoic contrast 0.5 ml followed by fluoroscopy imaging in both the procedures. Now, the goal of the injection was intra-articular. However, peri-articular spread of contrast was accepted if intra-articular injection was not achieved. Now, in USG-guided sacroiliac joint injection, a Sonosite M-Turbo ultrasound machine with a curvilinear transducer 5 to 2 MHz was used. A spinal needle was advanced from medial to lateral direction using an in-plane technique or an out-plane technique as deemed appropriate by the physician performing the procedure. Now, the pic that the authors have provided in the article, they can show this is medial side, this is lateral side. On the lateral side, we have the ileum. On medial side, we have the sacrum. This is the lateral crest. This is the S2 sacral foramina. And this is the joint that we are targeting with this needle coming from medial to lateral side. So just to elaborate it more, how to perform this, I've just included one video, small video. And this is the longitudinal view. We can see now we go on to the cross-sectional view. This is the PSIS and this is the medial crest. We will go from up to down, from up to down direction. And as this iliac crest, it disappears. This is the place. This is the sacrum and this is the place. This is the SI joint. We can see this S2 foramina here. And we have to come from this side and target this SI joint. Now, in fluoroscopic guided sacroiliac joint injection, again, Dr. Achal has already talked about this procedure. The same procedure was, the same technique was used. Now, in the outcome measurements, the primary outcome measured by the authors was the difference in the numerical rating score for pain at 1 month between the ultrasound and the fluoroscope groups. In the secondary outcomes, the numerical rating score, pain scores at 24 hours, 72 hours, 1 week, and 3 months after the study intervention were noted down. Then the limitation of physical functioning as measured by the Oswestry Disability Index at 1 month after the intervention was determined. Procedure-related variables like the time, radiation exposure, patient discomfort, and incidence of intra-articular versus peri-articular needle placement, these all things were determined. Then daily opioid consumption at 1 month and overall patient satisfaction at 3 months after the intervention were also assessed. So these were all the secondary outcomes of the study. In the statistical analysis, the primary hypothesis of the study was that ultrasound guidance for SI injection would be similar to the fluoroscope guidance in reducing mean NRS pain scores at 1 month after intervention. Now the significance level was 0.05 for assessing difference between the two image guided techniques with NRS pain score as a primary outcome. With a two-sided significance alpha level of 5% and power of 80%, 19 patients were needed in both groups to allow the detection of this difference. Now, allowing for a trial attrition rate of about around 10%, authors aim to enroll 20 patients in each group. So that is total of 40 patients. Now, continuous data with normal distribution was summarized in means and standard deviations, and data with non-normal normal distributions were summarized in medians and interquantile ranges. Categorical data was summarized as numbers and percentages. Variables with normal distribution were analyzed using t-test, and those with non-normal distribution were analyzed with Wilcoxon rank sum tests. Now, in the this is the cohort diagram, and we can see in the initial 44 patients were enrolled for this study, but four patients did not meet the inclusion criteria. That is, they were having bilateral SI joint pain. Now, 20 patients were distributed in each of the two arms. And we can see at 1 month of follow-up in the ultrasound arm, one patient did not come for the follow-up. Similarly, in the fluoroscopic group, at 1 month of follow-up, one patient did not come for the follow-up, as well as one of the patients did not complete a 3 months follow-up. However, whatever visits were incomplete of those patients, that was excluded from the final analysis. Now, this is the demographic of the patients who were involved in the study. So the age, we can see they were comparable between the patients, BMI, males and females. They were also comparable in this study. The only thing that is problematic that I found problematic was that the morphine consumption in milligrams. So in the ultrasound group, the mean morphine dose consumption was 2.25, while in the fluoroscopy group it was 30. However, the daily morphine consumption that they measured, that is less than 30 milligrams and more than 30 milligrams. So that was comparable between the two groups, but the actual mean morphine dose consumption was very much different in the two groups. But the p-value that they have said is not significant. Next was the comparison of the patient-related outcomes between the two groups. So the NRS pain score was measured at 24 hours, 72 hours, 1 week, 1 month, and 3 months post-procedure. And we can very well see that the NRS scores, they have reduced from the baseline till 3 months post-procedure. And it at 1 month of post-procedure time, so the p-value was 0.03, which was statistically significant. Similarly, in the fluoroscopy group also, the p-value was less than 0.01. So when compared to the baseline, the NR scores were reduced. However, when you compared the ultrasound group with the fluoroscopy group, so the p-value was not significant. That is, the results with both the ultrasound and the fluoroscopy were comparable. In the ODI scores, we can see that the pre-procedure ODI score in the ultrasound group, it has reduced by 4.7% at 1 month post-procedure. while in the fluoroscopy group, it has reduced by 11%. However, it was not statistically significant. When you compare the ultrasound and the fluoroscopy, it was not statistically significant. But we can see that the results, the increase in the ODI score or the betterment of the ODI, reduction in the ODI score was more significant in the fluoroscopy as compared to the ultrasound group. Now, when we come to the daily morphine consumption, so there was no change in the morphine consumption. So same number of patients consumed the almost the similar doses even after the procedure. Overall patient satisfaction. Now in this, if we club the satisfied and most satisfied group, we can see that around 55% of the patients were satisfied in ultrasound group, while around 70% patients were satisfied in fluoroscopy group. So again, the statistics show that it is not statistically significant, but if we club these two things, we can say that the patients are more satisfied in the fluoroscopy group than the ultrasound group. Now coming to the comparison of the procedure related outcomes between the two groups. Here we can see first, we can talk first about the intra-articular injection. So in the ultrasound group, only 50% of the injections were intra-articular, while the rest 50% were peri-articular. While in fluoroscopy group, 65% of the injections were intra-articular, while the rest were peri-articular. Now, when we come to the procedure time, so the procedure time was around 560 seconds in the ultrasound group, while in fluoroscopy group, it was 323 seconds, which was statistically significant. So it was statistically significant reduced time taken to perform the fluoroscopy guided procedure. But why was that? We'll come to it in some time. If we come talk about the procedure comfort discomfort, then it was not statistically significant. So it was same type of discomfort in both the procedures. Now, if you talk about this study, this was the first study to utilize both the patient related outcomes, that is the pain scores, the physical functioning, opioid consumption, overall satisfaction, as well as the procedure related outcomes, that is the accuracy, procedure time, patient discomfort, to compare ultrasound and fluoroscope guidance for the SIJ injection in patients with SIJ arthritis. Now, of the prior studies, there has been significant variability in the rates of intra-articular injections. So three prior studies have reported a higher intra-articular injection rates than our trials. And they reported the intra-articular placement of injection to be around 76%, 80%, 100%, 87%. So all these studies all reported a higher intra-articular needle placement. Now, this was explained by the fact that these studies included patients of younger age group. And we know that osteoarthritis changes can make it more difficult to access the intra-articular portion of the joint compared to the inflammatory pathologies. Now, this study has also suggested that peri-articular injection may have similar outcomes as the intra-articular injection, similar to the study conducted by Hartung et al. But the lack of the MCID and ODI scores in the studies partially explained by the severity and chronicity of the disease in enrolled patients as against the study conducted by G et al. Now, greater time, as we saw that the more time was required to perform the ultrasound guided procedure. So greater time could be explained by the inclusion of time for fluoroscopy confirmation. So included the confirmation time in the overall time of ultrasound guided procedure. That was the time was on a higher side. Now, the limitations accepted by the authors included, first was that there was a small sample size and therefore they could not conduct the non-inferiority analysis. The study was not powered to assess the safety aspects and complication rates of the two guidance techniques. So did not have any data regarding the complication rates associated with each of the two techniques. Although this study had a blinded observer for data collection in the post-procedure phase, ideally patients and procedure-specific assessment should also have been blinded to allocation of trial group. Next limitation accepted was that it was a short follow-up. It could have been extended to 6 months or 1 year. And finally, the study was limited to patients with BMI less than 35 kilogram per meter square. And the application of ultrasound for axial procedures in patients with higher BMI is technically challenging, and studies are required to evaluate the role of ultrasound for SIJ injection in this group of population. Now, in critical analysis, my first analysis is that though this study concludes that both ultrasound and fluoroscopy guided intervention results are comparable, I find a number of parameters that were measured were more in favor of fluoroscopy than the ultrasound. Secondly, there was a mismatch between the groups considering the mean dose of morphine that we have seen. there was no mention of the number of attempts taken for needle placement by the physicians in this study. And next, the comparison of, as we already discussed, comparison of adverse effects is very, very important when we are comparing two techniques, and it should have been done. So the take-home message is ultrasound can be used in cases of sacroiliac joint injections with comparable efficacy and accuracy of fluoroscopy. However, adequate training and expertise is required to conduct these procedures proficiently. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjog. Over to you. Yes, sir.
Good job again. I think probably this time you did a better critical analysis, because there were a few points which I noted down and you already mentioned them very nicely. And I think worth mentioning is there, when you said a morphine thing, morphine consumption is said to be, you know, when you're talking morphine consumption, then you're talking, if you look at the morphine consumption chart, go back to the morphine consumption chart quickly. So I want to mention something where people sometimes make a big mistake. Just put the slide up quickly. Morphine consumption. Yeah, look at the morphine consumption. You look at this, if the morphine consumption is less than, it's okay, 2.25, you know, look at this, pre-procedure and post-procedure 1.13. So anywhere, when you're talking about, if you just go a step down, pre-procedure less than 30 milligram or more than 30 milligram, same post-procedure, then you're having a 16 people having less than 30 milligram, 4 people having more than 30 milligram. Where is that stuff, you know? You have a range of 0 to 22.5. How come there's no one is taking more than 30 milligram? In you are fudging the data, 16:4. So that's something where it was a blunder. Next chart is okay, next chart is acceptable. The first chart which I thought was worth mentioning. Another thing is, it has been talked, the patient discomfort, you said is discomfort. Somebody is observing patient discomfort. Is it objective or subjective? That has to be mentioned. Is the patient reporting or the observer reporting patient's discomfort? So it is very different when patient himself reports or somebody else reports. So that has to be mentioned. Subjective, objective, you know, reporting was there. Another very important between you two, Anshul, you and as well as Sanjog, what do you think is the volume of the SIJ in normal individuals? Anybody? Okay. Volume of SIJ, SI joint. What is the volume? Normal volume. Anybody can come up quickly.
2 to 3 mL.
No, it's 1 to 2.5 mL. 2.5 is the upper limit, you know. And that too, you know, depending on normal individuals, you know, when you're having busy joints, then it's a different story altogether. But here in the two studies where we are injecting, we are bound to inject 2.5 ml to have a comparative evaluation, because all patients have to be given 2.5 ml. When the joint volume is about 1.5 ml, how can one inject 2.5 ml? That was a very big catch point. And if you look at the Sonage study, the Canadian study, they injected 1 plus 3, 4 ml.
4 ml.
4 ml plus 0.5 ml dye. Don't forget the dye. 0.5 ml dye is already in there. So it's 4.5 ml. How can you inject in the SIJ 4.5? So what they bind and they did is, they went inside, inject what they could give inside, what it could take. The rule of the game is, when doing SIJ injections, small joint injections, facet joint injections, rule of the game is, give what it could take. So you always prepare smaller volumes, what it can really take. If you give higher volumes, you are bound to rupture the joint and it's going to spill all over. And you have seen epidural spills in the facet, and then you've seen rupturing the joints which happened. But this sometimes they welcome, because periarticular spill is welcome in many patients, because many times they said it is more of the periarticular ligaments and other structures which is causing pain than the intraarticular. So it's welcome. Some people don't give intraarticular at all because it kind of damages the cartilage. So they tend to avoid intraarticular, they give periarticular. Sometimes it happens in few patients. Like in facet also, sometimes people don't like to give intraarticular, they want to give periarticular, pericapsular. So this is an important thing. I thought when they're doing a study about 4.5 ml injection in all patients, I had a little catch there. How come they could manage so much volume in the SIJ? Second is morphine consumption. Satisfaction levels. Yes, satisfaction, they have written in the conclusion. The satisfaction is same, it's not different. But you look at the scores. The satisfaction level is different. Miss, if you look at the scores, I have a chart. Yes, you put a chart, satisfaction chart. There's another one. There's another chart which is there, satisfaction level. One above, I think, satisfaction level. Yeah, here. Look at the lower one. Satisfaction level is different. You look at this, most satisfied is 15 versus 20, and the satisfied is 55 versus 35, and not satisfied 25 versus 45. So this cannot be taken as same. This is little different. So you, just for the sake of saying that USC is good enough it does not mean that you starting it is satisfactory. So there is a difference. But yes, I strongly feel, and I want to make a comment here, that with the advent of time, more and more people are using ultrasound, the ultrasound machines are getting better, the procedurists are getting better day by day, more expertise, and they can really manage the SIJ as good as doing a fluoro one. Yes, you can combine, like a combined fluoro ultrasound, CFU method is already there. For a few transition cases, you can combine fluoro and ultrasound, all procedures which you talk, which can be combined together, like stellate or cervical procedures or other procedures, and then you can always transition to the ultrasound. If there is a problem in the ultrasound, you can always pull your machine in, CR machine in, and then do a check and proceed with that. There's nothing like fixed rule. But yes, transition is welcome. I think it's a good thing. It's a good transition, by the way, because machines are getting better. That's the whole point. And there's no mention of post-procedure medication in your paper, right? Like she mentioned about post-procedure medication, there's no mention of that. So that I think probably had to be mentioned. Now there are a few points which are common, which I thought we you both can talk it out. One is the 38 number of patients or low number of patients. The study can go with the higher number of patients for a better calculation point of view, but it's okay. They could take the minimum patient where they can make the calculation. That's a 38 number. That's how they came up with this. Another point is how many shots were given. Like we're talking now, very important. SIJ, when you do a diagnostic block, you have two shots in diagnostic also. And we are talking the first shot or the second shot. Because satisfaction level, the success rate is different between first shot and second shot. So which shot is it? Is it first shot or second shot you are trying to do the study on? So it's going to matter. It's really going to matter. So that's the important thing. And another is this volume we discussed about. The linear, yes. You used the curvilinear probe and Anchal paper used the linear probe. Yes. Now, can you justify your stand why, Anchal, you use linear and why you use curvilinear quickly?
That's what we were discussing earlier too. I think their patients could be, they excluded patients with BMI more than 35.
Yeah, so that happened in your case also. You also excluded more than 35.
Right, but they could have like thinner patients because they were younger patients. They could see it with the linear probe better. But usually we use convex probe when it comes to the spine procedures most of the times.
It's more to do with the population, the Canadian population versus Indian population. We get a little thinner patients than in your kind of population with SIJ pain, with the sacroiliitis. So you could start a linear. Another point which is in your favor is because you started from sacral cornua, you started from below up. Going below up, you have a lesser of tissue in there and you can meet your SIJ much, superficial than what he is trying to do, because his SIJ intervention is going to be a little deeper, to start. Because when you're starting from above, below, the SIJ is much deeper. Another point which is mentioned is that your SIJ is at level of S2 foramina, somewhere around S2 foramina. Yes. And it should not be right at the lowermost end of the SIJ, it should be a centimeter above, ideally speaking. There is a reason for that. If you got the lowermost part of the foramina, lowermost part of the SIJ, you tend to go across sometime and you can go into the pelvis. There are vessels, there are viscera, there are bladder, and so we always say empty the bladder before the procedure. So it's advised that way. Yes, there are studies when you say you cannot make it at S2 foramina level, means lower SIJ level. You can go in upper SIJ level like S1 foramina. And that happens mostly because in your Soneji study, the population age was 18 to 85, remember. And your Anchal, the population age was demographic 18 to 60.
Right.
So in his population, there's going to be more osteophytosis, more of the damaged joints. So sometimes it gets difficult to get into these old joints, typically when there's a rough and osteophytosis joint. So you can go a step above, S1 foramina and can go inside and manage it. In any case, you have to manage needle placement intra-articular. Try to look at the arthrogram, satisfy yourself with the arthrogram. Only needle placement is not enough. And then you just finish with the procedure. So that's going to be important. Okay, another point is, there's no mention about, in both studies, how much were in plane and how much out of plane. Do you think it's important or not, quickly?
Right, I think they showed the picture for in plane.
Yeah, both of you showed in plane.
But so ultimately they are confirming it with the fluoroscope. So the placement of the needles. So what technique they are using, I don't think so it should matter.
It should matter because your attempt at the lower SIJ, you can do both ways. You can do the in plane, which is a little longer length, going more angulated from medial to lateral, and you can go outer plane, which is a little more vertical at the lower SAJ, remember. So it matters. So it, with the expertise, when you do more and more cases, you would like to go the outer plane right at the M plane. We draw an M line at the M mode, and you can go at the middle of it, and you can do outer plane. You can be just in the joint, and you can manage it very well and very effectively. So you don't always have to be in plane. Second is going in plane with the linear probe. I think it's going to be a little difficult because your angle has to be coming from the medial to lateral. So you curvilinear probe is better that way. And when you're doing a outer plane, you can use any. You can look linear or curvilinear. So that's why it's important, because there will be going to be definitely going to be a study. I'm telling you beforehand now. You will be presenting another paper down the line next year, you know, that in plane or outer plane SIJ block, which is better of the two. So, and with which probe? Which probe? So I am bringing this point up for your next paper, you know.
We'll only present, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, they will come and present. Yeah. Right? Another is, yes, there is no mention of the color, you know, doing a color study.
Arterial.
Always do a Doppler. Always, any ultrasound procedure, anywhere in the body, you don't put a needle before you've done a Doppler. So there's no mention. They should put in a word at least they did Doppler study, because now I'm trying to bring up a point, important point. There was a very good paper which mentioned about the ultrasound. They said 34 out of 55 ultrasound studies, they found vessels. 34 out of 55. Of which the 7 were intra-articular, 4 were both intra and periarticular, and 23 were periarticular. This is a very big study which has come lately, 2019-20. This is a very nice study. So with so much vessels going around the lower SAJ, it's good to put in a Doppler and avoid that vessel which we are going to go through. Sometimes you say they have done even the phased arthrogram, they put in a dye, they found in good number of times, like they said 3 out of 55 times, you could see the vessel flow. You run off, you know. So we have been seeing, like we are trying to put in dye, we don't see a dye, so there's a vessel run off. Then you do a live flow and you find there's a vessel, clear cut vessel, and you avoid that vessel, change your position. Although, in initial thought, I used to think that we might have gone intraosseous, because they're osteoporotic patients, you're trying to put your needle, it has gone into the bone, you're trying to put a dye and it's showing a runoff, so it is intraosseous. Now I realize it is the vascular, not intraosseous, you know. So that is something which you have to be very careful. So the message at the end of the day is, everybody has to understand, when you do a procedure, definitely put a Doppler. And they've done a good study, they've done a power Doppler in good number of patients, and they could catch sacroiliitis much earlier than the clinical and the radiological diagnosis. So that is another advantage point of putting a Doppler, power Doppler for that matter, right? And another is discomfort. Some study, your study, Anchal, there is discomfort of the doctor vis-a-vis discomfort of the patient in your study, Sanjog. So that's something comparative. You're talking about doctor's discomfort and he's talking about patient's discomfort. So it's going to be important to understand. And in Sanyog, your study, you did three out of four tests which have to be positive.
Yes, sir.
Clinical test. In Anchal, your study, three out of five.
Three out of five, right.
What is the right and why? Quick. What is the right and why? Why are we talking 3 out of 5, 4 out of 5?
Because the sensitivity of tests is not...
Exactly. Go ahead. Yes.
Because sensitivity of these tests is hardly 60-70%. If
these
tests are coming positive, then the chances of diagnosis of it increases. That's I don't.
Yeah, there's so many tests, you know. They have labeled those tests. And they said 3 out of 5 are positive. That becomes sensitive. And the sensitivity of 3 out of 5 is... they have come out with something like... I'll give you that number, you know. Yeah, 91% sensitivity and 76% specificity in 3 out of 5 tests. I think 4 out of 5, I don't know what is the right thing. They have taken the 4 tests, you've taken 5 tests. I think 5 would be a better option when you're trying to diagnose clinically. Then obviously you're going to do a diagnostic block, because your radiology may not be helpful in good number of times. It is said already. So that is another point, right? So there are few things which is common, fluoro. Now these are about papers. There are few things which is otherwise we can discuss beyond paper when we are talking about SIJ or we're talking about fluoro or versus ultrasound. One thing is, when you're getting into the joint, and as Siddharth would vouch it, then you definitely get a feel of entering the joint. Remember, all joints where you just enter, you go to the capsule inside and you get the free, it gets a little free. So that is important to have the feel of the joint. So this is important. Then obviously you do a dye check. Now there is something which is called, your needle is looking very great, but your dye is not going good, dye is not looking good. So could there be a reason for that? You, Anchal, quickly. You're inside the joint, but you're not getting arthrogram quickly.
maybe it's periarticular.
No, here intra-articular, I said the word. Okay, it's periarticular because when you go through the ligaments also, periarticular ligaments also, that gives you free feel.
They may be the joint.
You can call it like an epidural versus spinal, you know, going epidural and you got LOR, then you're going spinal also. So it's more like that. Now, less quickly.
The joint volume is less, it is fused.
Fused is one aspect, definitely. One is, another point is good number of times, you see, your needle tip is inside the cartilage. Please understand. You're inside the joint, but in, you're dipped into the cartilage. So in trying to put in a dye, it is not showing up. So you just change your needle tip. So I'm giving a lead because you will see these things happening very practically. You are right there inside, but your needle is against the cartilage. So you're not trying to inject. You're trying to inject, it's not showing up. So these things do happen. And obviously the joint is a little angulated. So for some reason, I said initially, you all don't always try to go from above below because you can get into the pelvis. This should always, when you're trying to see the lower end of the joint, you see cephalocaudal tilt, which you mentioned, I think, earlier also. But here, when you're trying to inject into the lower part of the joint, you just try to put a, you know, C-arm again a little straight because then you can start from below up also. Because once you diagnose the lower joint line, then it becomes important that you're not going to go out of the joint, anterior to the joint, in other words. Remember, if you look at all arthrograms and your procedure images, which is in later fluoroscopy, the dog here, you see, you see needle going from below up. If you watch very carefully, you all these images, they're going needle from below up. Nothing is coming from above below. All the way showing cephalocaudal tilt initially. What about the prolotherapy? Siddharth, you did a talk on prolo and all. I think I want you to educate people. Prolo vis-a-vis PRP, vis-a-vis steroids.
I think prolo is a very good option if, you know, especially if you want to do it periarticularly and it has a lot of potential. And plus, if you add to it the cost benefit and the number of times you can simply and easily do it, then it becomes actually very good. PRP, if cost is not a factor, I will always, you know, use PRP instead of the dextrose or something. Because it has been found to have almost similar results, and in fact, in some cases, it's even better. So that's my take on it. I routinely don't use, you know, dextrose or other things around the sacroiliac joint, but mostly it is only either a steroid or plasma, whatever.
I think these boys, they did talk on prolotherapy as well as there was a talk on SAJ last time. So that is a very important point. Yes, they have already done a study where they see PRP is better than the prolo because they do a lower number of procedures in the PRP than the and the end result is better. Although steroid may be happy to begin with, but over a period of 11-12 weeks and other things, there is a crossover. The PRP or the prolo are better off because these joints have a lot of loose ligament. The ligaments become loosened out, so there is a lot of pain and everything, instability in the joints, like listasis kind of scenario, you know. So in the lumbar spine, so the same thing is happening in the SIJ. So you have to strengthen these ligaments, and that is very, very important. Doing all this prolo and the dextrose and everything is so important. And the last I want to just educate is the last few lines, and then we can do closing as and when you want. About the ultrasound, the needle view is so important. Now there are a few tips on needle viewing. First, I want you people to tell us, and then I'll compliment. Please go ahead, Anchal and Sanjo. What are few important tips of the needle visualization in the ultrasound procedures? Quickly.
I think first you mentioned already the ergonomics. If you are, your eye alignment, your bed, and everything, you know, it should be in line. And second thing is what I have, figured out over the years is you. Watch your hand, because when you, if you're right-handed, then you kind of tend to, you know, your hands kind of tend to bend on the other side, so that kind of needle goes out of plane. And then right amount of gel, of course.
The needle has to be at the center of the footprint of the probe, and secondly the angle at which you are entering. So that is also important. If you're a linear probe, then the angle should be 45-50 degrees. So at that angle, the the needle is visualized very nicely. If you go on
Not linear 45. You have to be as parallel as possible to the foot of the probe, you know. 45 is not great. 45 is good for curvy linear probe, not for linear probe. So as parallel as possible, do a heel-toe maneuver, you know. If you're not finding a needle well, do a heel-toe maneuver. Or other points, come on quickly, there are about 8-10 points. Quickly, what you can remember, remember, you know, rest I'll compliment quickly. Echogenic needles. Now, there are very good smart machines now, which is a very good needle visualization technologies, which is already there. So they give you a better needle visualization. Then there can be compounding, you know, with all those things. Plus, there are few new smart machines. It's like a smartphones. They have a neck, you know, they keep telling you the needle tip is, you found the target. It's like a navigation thing. Yeah. It's like a navigation. They found that you're given the target. Now you're trying to put a needle. It tells you that the needle is going away or going towards the target. It's like navigation. So it really keeps telling you you're going off the track, you know. So it tries to bring you back. So from red to yellow to green. So if it's green, you are on right track. If it's yellow, you are off track. And red, you are totally off track. And you have to reset everything. So these are things because you're not seeing the needle yet. But your machine is seeing it. So these are very smart things which is going up, which is coming up. With the advent of newer machines coming, the things will change. I won't be surprised if you see 3D or 4D machines coming in due course of time. Or color coding coming in due course of time. Of the tissue color coding. I won't be surprised at all. I talked this long back to Australian ultrasonologist, very famous ultrasonologist. That this it is bound to come. Then is the quickest. Per procedure body parts, then you have a preset. We all know about the preset, about as per the tissue, your depth, your gain, your focus. It has to be so, it has to be right. Your probe, your frequency, you cannot mismatch. Any one mismatch can lead you a failure of the procedure. So these are very, very preset, and with experience you come to know. But yes, in the meantime, you can always have it from your books or from your seniors, and you have a guide like Dr. Siddharth, who is telling and teaching everything. You can always in touch with other people, like including me. If you have any queries, we can always be always there to help guide. Make a group, like Dr. Siddharth is already doing. Make a group and you put your queries there. There's so many pain groups going on these days. I'm very, very happy with the activity of the pain groups and the teaching, inter-teaching going on, intergroup teaching going on. And the trajectory and probe in plane and out of plane, not to miss on that. That is important thing. Power Doppler, as mentioned you already. Right transducer, gain, depth, color. Yes, screen. And record. Record your work. I am doing that mistake. So many cases, so many good cases you are doing, we are not recording. And look at the Westerners, they do a case. Every case is recorded and they pull up 5 good cases and the paper is on. I might have done 50 of such cases. But just because I didn't record it, so it has gone to trash. The point is record your cases as far as possible. It's important. I think I missed on initial cases, but now I'm recording my cases. So that's why you are low on paper and presentations. Prepare all your injections beforehand. When your probe is in your hand, you don't do anything thereafter. You just do the injection part. Its trolley should be at hand distance, and then you do all your procedure needles because your one hand is on the probe. You're only one-handed man now thereafter. And you have to do all your procedures. It should be arm's length. And one fallacy in this study, which I want to mark both of you, when you said your time is counted when you put your first probe on the patient after cleaning and draping. In all our education till now in ultrasound procedures, we do a pre-scans. So where is that pre-scan thing gone? Here you are not pre-scanning the patient. You're doing scanning during the procedure. So pre-scanning is gone. So there is a fallacy, I would call it a fallacy, but they're trying to do pre-scan in the procedure part instead of any pre-scan. Also, in all our procedures, we always pre-scan patient and then we clean drape the probe patient and then we start with the procedure. So that's another important thing, right? And
that's the most important part. If you miss the pre-scan, you're
doomed
to fail.
Pre-scan planned your trajectory, your probe. I have changed my procedure sometime. I changed my needle trajectories. I've changed my probe sometime. And that's going to be important. This is going to be very, very important. And another important point is sometime you scan with one probe like linear. And then you want to do a procedure curvilinear, like in suprascapular. You want to do a procedure. You scanned it very good position with the linear. Now you want to do procedure which is deeper one. So you take a curvilinear. So you might have changed other way around. Sometime you see, and another important is always when you are blinded at the tip, like in intercostal block, or you do a facet thoracic thoracic facet block, or here in this position SIJ block, and always try to touch and hit the bone there. Bone is your friend here, and then you redirect your needle. Now you know the depth, which depth you are on, and now you redirect in the same depth. Now depth give you an idea. Try to look at the tip of the needle now, because if you lose the tip of the needle, you can be anywhere in the body. So that's not on. Ultrasound guided procedure rule of the game is you may see shaft or not, but always never miss on the needle tip. So you try to visualize everything in length. That's the whole point. Anything else you want to add, Dr. Siddharth?
No, I think if there are any questions from the audience, if there are any questions from the audience, we'd like to take them now. Otherwise, we'd like to just go to the end. Please post your questions, and or if you like to unmute yourself, just let me know. I will unmute you. And I hope many of you are doing these procedures in your routine practice.
And my advice to all people around and people to new students, always take a probe in your hand. Even if you're doing the fluoroguide procedure, you start seeing the ultrasound guided anatomy and you get using adapt over a period of time, all still at ganglion block, other blocks which you think are cervical facet block. Have an ultrasound machine on during the procedure and preferably sterilized probe. So then your life becomes easy because you're getting more adapted over a period of time. That's the whole thing. So keep that in mind. So that you can transition easy. It's a transition CFU. That's what is combined fluoro ultrasound unit, and VU transition from fluoro to ultrasound or other way around for that matter.
Great. So I think Dr. Sandhyog, Dr. Achal, do you have any questions?
I'll ask one question, sir. In the post-pregnancy, the patients, they mainly, many patients develop this SIJ because of the hypermobility on those. So in those cases, the dextrose and prolotherapy will be better than SIJ injections, or what do you prefer?
See, the point here is that in the pregnancy, post-pregnancy, this is a more of a lax ligament, which is said. And in multiple pregnancy, it happens more often, you know. So always said when you have a multi-para patients, there's a laxative ligament which is causing the pain. So you try to do a prolo part at the ligaments. Again, if you're doing during pregnancy, because this is known, the SIJ dysfunction is known during pregnancy, if you have to, ideally you have to avoid, but if you have to, then you cannot put patient prone. You put a semi-prone, or you put a lateral position, and your procedure you can do in lateral also in USG guided. Obviously, the floor is out of question here, so USG guided, you can do that if need be. But yes, there is a typical sacroiliitis, I'm not talking about SIJ dysfunction now. Sacroiliitis, obviously you have to go intra-articular and do your needful intra-articular in that case. And then you might have to give a steroid. If you have to, you have to. That's what it is. Yes, there are 10% patients, 70% patients will have low back pain. About 10% will have a post-delivery pain also. And SIJ is known to be related to pregnancy and other things because it's all to do with the pelvis and around. And that's where if they don't get stabilized well, then you can go and do the procedure. This time you can use a fluoro post-delivery, you know, if need be. But yes, ultrasound is a very good modality. I would be much happy if you can just do the ultrasound, because they already said intra-articular versus peri-articular doesn't make much difference. And here in the post-delivery, you want to give more of peri-articular also. So there's no harm giving. But you can combine intra-articular versus peri-articular if need be, you can combine. Like people are doing PRP. So what they're doing is they're very smartly going inside then outside, giving it all around. It's a very smart job, very, very smart thinking. And do it, combine the two. You know, that can be done.
Thank you.
Great. So I think thank you all for participating in the discussion. Thank you, Dr. Sandhyog and Dr. Achal, for the excellent presentations. Before we end, we'll take one question from the audience. Dr. Madhvi is asking, is there any role of Botox in sacroiliac joint?
You're talking about the joint intra-articular, you're talking about the peri-articular. Again, the point is Botox is more to do with the muscles. So we are not having a problem like a piriformis spasm or other spasm like or anterior scalene syndrome where you have all this or great obstinate love entrapment syndrome. There's nothing more of entrapment thing. Yes, we have a posterior clunial, we have a medial clunial nerve entrapment neuropathies, but they are not the muscular entrapments. They are more of the ligamentous or heart tissue entrapments, which has to be dealt differently. Like
for not in my opinion.
That's different. Bald, you can always do the finalization, you can always do the other things, and you can always do the LA plus steroid block. Yes, Botox doesn't have much. Yes, some people have tried Botox in the, because there are nerve endings inside the joint, like in the knee. Sometimes people have tried Botox. They have tried Botox in the SIJ also, but not much of success is there with this. And you don't try the Botox normally in these patients. Yes, there are a few enthusiasts where you fail again and again. There's no harm trying. Again, remember, Botox is not for permanent. It is there for 6 months only. is not a permanent solution to a problem.
There is one advice which I want to give to all these type of questions, people, if you are really thinking about your patient going this way, which is this all treatments are experimental. So ideally you should not do this unless it's a part of a trial and you are actually trialing and recording. And it's quite risky for your practice also. Just imagine, patient getting ready, and even if you do no harm, but still if you fail to get the relief, why to do something where you have more, you have better treatment options already available. So for sacroiliac joint, you have a lot of options which are available. I think try those rather than...
Yeah, I think probably thereafter, once we're talking about SIJ injections, we're talking allele steroid. Don't forget, there's a very nice good treatment of RF, which is there in waiting in line.
Yes.
So with the conventional RF, the cool RF that is already there in line. So you don't have to miss on those very important things. We are talking just one factor, intra-articular injection. We talked about other thing whereby you don't have to do a second injection. Why you have to do a repeated Botox? You just jolly well better do an RF which works for 2-3 years, which works much longer time and much better effect. So, and much more scientific also. So that will be a better option than just doing the Botox, ideally speaking.
Great. So thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Sanjog. Thank you, Dr. Anshul. And special thanks to Neeraj Ansar, who spent his valuable time and always ready to teach all of us.
So always a so pleasure. Much. And I'm very happy you and I developed such a good academic platform. I'm so, so impressed. And thank you, Siddharth. You're doing a good job. Good. Good. I compliment you and congratulate you.
Thank you so much, sir. So now let's move on to the next steps. The secret of getting things done is to act. So join our mailing list. We have the WhatsApp group link already. I have posted in the chat on email, and get ready for a for a new webinar which is going to come up. That is on ultrasound guided spine procedures, and it will be on June 25th and 26th. So 6 to 8 p.m. So just get ready for this. We'll post more content very soon. So. Thank you all and have a very good night. Thank you.
Okay. Good night. Good night, my friends. Pleasure.
Good night.
Pleasure. Nice. Nice. Nice hearing. Good talks.
Thank you.